Live from Hollywood, California, VJ Vernon Husky, the Big Vanilla Funnies, unsportsmanlike conduct.
Unsportsmanlike conduct.
Atomically, Socrates' philosophies and hypotheses can't define how I be dropping these mockeries. Lyrically perform armed robbery, flee with the lottery. Possibly they spotted me.
Battle that is my joy. Plus, I got the Wu T-shirt on, man. So I had to open up with that one right there, man. Welcome, everybody, to VJ's Unsportsmanlike Conduct. I am your host, as always, VJ Vernon Husky, VVH, the Big Vanilla Funny, the Big Vanilla Shot, the Crazy Kobe, Blue Eye Barkley, Mr. Never Shut Up, VA's Top Talk Boy, and the Big Vanilla Color Card, because I got a deck of them joints, because sometimes they got to be dealt out when they need to be dealt out. I am your Big Vanilla Vegas dealer. Try to say that five times. Great show for you guys, man. Listen, I know I have been off the air for the last 3.5 weeks. I've been very busy with school, finishing my degree in journalism and mass communication so I can some way, somehow roll into my master's degree at some point one day, Lord willing. So I haven't been on. We had the NFL draft show. I want to thank everybody that did tune in to the NFL draft show. Thank y'all so much, man. Shout out to my man, Kenneth. He's got something new coming up. The guy that was the co-host that entire day. Great reaction from people. They said that they loved us. They thought we had great chemistry. Him and I are supposed to be putting something together on our own on a different level with sports talk and just pop culture talk. So everybody tuning in to that show, I appreciate you guys. We had so much fun doing the NFL show. I showed up suited and booted. Y'all saw me. I was dolphined out. I had the dolphin flowers on. And, you know, I had to rethink the draft. And I'm not going to talk about the draft today because I have a tremendous show for you guys today. This is a super show. I'm going to be on for about 2.5 hours. Like, I'm talking today. I got some stuff to say. And I got everything I need. I got the pill. We're going to talk this. We're going to talk that. And then I got the pigskin. Because we're going to talk this. So I'm prepared. I'm super prepared. So, but I want to thank everybody, man, for sticking with me. We are back today, tomorrow, and Wednesday. The next 3 days with the NBA playoffs and with the NHL playoffs going on. I have a lot to say. We'll jump into some Major League Baseball stuff, too, because I think the league is starting to open up a little bit. We're now kind of moving into June. I think bats are warming up. Pitchers' arms are definitely warming up. 6 no-hitters this point in the season. Never been done in Major League Baseball before. So there are some great things going in. So I don't want to diss baseball because I know we tend to do that as Americans. And we want to talk some NHL playoffs because I keep telling you people, man, anybody that wants to hear me, wants to listen, if you don't want to watch hockey, fine. If you don't want to watch hockey when the USA men and women team are good in the Olympics, I ain't mad at you. We got a lot to do here in America, okay? We have a lot of sports to watch. We have a lot of TV shows to watch. We have a lot of reality to watch. We have so many streaming services. Everybody can binge watch whatever the hell they want to, when they want to, where, how. It doesn't matter. So hockey is not up there for Americans, and I get that. You only want to cheer during the Olympics? I get that too. But if you are not watching at least 2 or 3 playoff hockey games a week during this time of year to add into the basketball mix that's going on right now, plus with all the rookie mini camps that just happened and all the OTAs that just happened in NFL football, plus we just got through the spring games for college football, so we're getting our mind revved up. You heard fans at the game yesterday, over the weekend, fans are back. Like, it feels. We're going to talk about that Knick game. We're definitely going to get into that Knickerbocker game. That was, that was like sex for me. For me, I don't know what it's like for you, but for me, it was like sex to watch the Knicks play yesterday in May, in late May, leading into Memorial Day. Telling my age right now, of course, I opened the show at Wu-Tang, so you know I'm not a young buckaroo. You know I'm an OG. Took me back. It took me to Oregon. Defense. It's just, I always say, I'm not a Knicks fan, but I always say sports is better. Don't kid yourself. Don't kid yourself over markets and over branding and over players and over social media and all this other BS. Don't kid yourself. Sports is best when the most notable franchises and teams play the longest and play the more important games deep in the season. Period. The Patriots are good for the NFL because you love them or hate them. Dallas is good for the NFL because it's the number one money-making sports franchise on the globe, in the world. Nobody's worth more in sports than the Dallas Cowboys. Love them or hate them, you gotta play them 7 or 8 national televised games. You have to put them on, and it's better if they get to the playoffs. It's better if they win a wild card. It's better if they get to the divisional round. It will be great if they got to a conference championship game with Dak Prescott this year, coming off the injury, with the big contract. Smart first-round draft pick with Michael Parsons, linebacker at Penn State. So now your defense is solidified. It would be great. It'd be great if Aaron Rodgers stayed in Green Bay. I understand if he wants to go, but it's great that he's there. It's great for baseball right now. Why baseball grabbed my attention, AL East. I grew up in the AL East area. I grew up in the NL East area. Two most competitive divisions in baseball. NL West is getting tight. Colorado's out of there. But you have the Padres, you have the Giants, and you have the Dodgers. The Dodgers went on a slump and just knocked off 7 in a row back again. So Tampa Bay's got 10 in a row. The Giants, I mean, like, it's baseball. There's some divisions. But those two on the East Coast. AL East, NL East, it's tight. Why? Mets are good. Yankees are good. Red Sox are good. The big franchises, they're good. So it's better. Period. You don't have a bacon, egg, and cheese sandwich that's good because the toast was great. It's the bacon. Let's not fool ourselves. How's the bacon cooked? Is it burnt bacon? Is it lightly burnt bacon? Is it rubbery? Is it chewy? Is it crunchy? Is it crunch chewy bacon? That's kind of good. As long as there ain't no white showing. That's fat. The fat got to be brown for me to eat a slice of bacon. But let's not kid ourselves. What makes the bacon, egg, and cheese sandwich great? It's the bacon. Or it would just be an egg and cheese sandwich. Nobody ever said that sandwich was great because of the bread. Rarely, but then it's got to be like some rosemary, parmesan, apple crisp, pecan, walnut, honey drizzled, gluten-free, non-Ezekiel bread. Like, where the... Okay, yeah, I guess that would make... How about just give me a slice of that? Just toast that and give me some strawberry preservatives and some butter and just give me that. I don't need whatever else you're going to put on it with all that shit in it. Let's not fool ourselves. So leagues are better when the good teams are good and the Knicks are in the playoffs. It's just better for... They put them at the right time slot yesterday. Nationally televised game like that. Ratings went up. I know I bang on the NBA about the ratings in the regular season, but sometimes you got to look around the league. Who are we watching? Where are the big teams? Where's Boston? Where's the Lakers in the NFL? Where's the Patriots? Where's the Packers? Where's the Cowboys? Where's the Giants? LA teams, big city. LA, the Rams are good. Rams are picked to probably go to the Super Bowl this year or at least battle with Tampa. The leagues are just better when teams are good. And there is so much goodness going on right now. And I want to start off with this. I normally would have an opening rant. I normally would pick a topic to really go in on, but I don't. I want to get into the show because we have so much material and so much great shit material. There's the stand-up comedian in me, right? We have so much research that I've done over the last few days and some things that I want to talk about. And we'll start with this. Last weekend, the NBA basketball itself had its induction ceremony to the Hall of Fame up in Springfield, Massachusetts, which I've been to before. I was taken there, I want to say maybe 11 years ago, 11, 12 years ago, I went there. Maybe 13, could have been 13 years ago. But I went up there for the day and just had a day. I wore my Isaiah Thomas, Mitchell and Ness, a throwback authentic. I had the fresh, red matching Yankee on. Like I went fresh and I rocked my Isaiah jersey. Got some great pictures, saw some great stuff, had a great time. It is a miraculous place. It's a beautiful place. If you've never been, it's a great place. It's outstanding. So I've had the pleasure of going there. So whenever, and they didn't have it at the Hall of Fame like they normally would because it's really tight quarters there. But they did get a chance to have something, especially with COVID and quarantine kind of taking our last year and a half away from us. So watching the induction, I'm looking at the three guys that's getting in. And the one thing that hits me, I think, the most is it's the last of the legends. This class is the last of the legends. And that's because I don't consider Wade, Melo, LeBron, Durant, Steph. I love Steph. I like Steph a lot. But I don't know if he's a legend. Garnett's a legend. Kobe's a legend. Duncan's a legend. These guys are legends. The things that these guys did will never be done. Tim Duncan is a dinosaur. Tim Duncan is the last great big man in basketball. And it's not even close. Embiid, he would eat Embiid's lunch right now. If Tim, give me 26, 27-year-old Tim Duncan, he would destroy Embiid right now. He would destroy him. Embiid will get 22, 23. He's talented. He'll hit some threes, hit some jump shot. Timmy will lock a lot of that shit down. There's no competition to Embiid. That's why it's like, how do you not average 35? Like, seriously, you should average. Yeah, you got 28, 29 this year. Yeah, there's not three more buckets there you can find? There's gotta be three more buckets that you can find, in my opinion. There's gotta be. But you think about a guy like Garnett, a guy like that came out of high school, first high school player drafted since Moses Malone in 95 in that class, and just came into the league, had to learn, had to warm up, but think about the guys he was going against, Olajuwon, and playing against Ewing and those guys. If you think about it, he comes in 95, Ewing had went to the finals the year before. Olajuwon, Ewing, David Robinson, Rick Smith, some really good big men that he had to contend with. Then at the power forward position, you're still playing Barkley. You're still playing Karl Malone. You're still playing Sean Kemp at that point. That class and then a few classes after that, they came in. Kobe's class is the next class. Duncan's class is the class after that. You think about just those 3 years in a row. It was just bam, bam, bam. Three Hall of Famers. Hit, hit, hit. It's like, it was like blackjack, man. Like, hit me. And then the NBA said, hit me. And then the NBA 97 said, hit me. And it gave us Garnett, Mamba, and the big fundamental. Even when you go back and you look at their accomplishment and you look at their numbers, there's nothing that you would say any three of these gentlemen did ever playing the sport of basketball that's fluff. Or that was stat padding. Or that was, you know, there's an asterisk with it. Everything that these three guys did was legit. Everything was legit. Kobe shoots too much. Kobe is a gunner. AI was a gunner. Gilbert Arenas, there's gunners in the league. But Kobe could do it. It could burn you for 81. Could be a seventh seed and be up 3-1 against the MVP that was stolen from him twice. Kobe, and if you think about him, Garnett, and Duncan, they had to battle each other for 15 straight years. Not only are they Hall of Famers, Duncan stood in Minnesota's way. Minnesota was in the Western Conference Finals once against LA, lost in six. And Kobe and Duncan had to battle each other for 20 straight seasons. Kobe Bryant is on the Tony Parker documentary right now that's on HBO Max. Go check it out. Speaking of HBO Max, they're winning the streaming wars right now, ladies and gentlemen. I'm just saying, if you don't have it, just go get it. I got it. I'm going to just go ahead and pay the $14.99. It's $15. My gym membership is $15. You know, it is what it is, but it's my enjoyment. I watch a lot of stuff there. It has Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, so I love Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. So does my son. And even though we have the complete set, shout out to my man, Luis Estrada, for hooking me up with that. I still got to pay him for that. Oh, God. I can't believe I forgot that. I got you, Luis. But he's got it. I have to complete this set, but it streams too, so it's easier to connect it to the TV instead of going DVD after DVD after DVD. So it's HBO Max, they're winning right now. But Kobe is on there with a Tony Parker documentary, and he talks about it. He says, I've had more championships if it weren't for them. If it weren't for them, I've had more championships. If they weren't in the Lakers' way, and listen, Fisher bailed them out once with the .4, and I mean, bail out, like Shaq said, one lucky shot deserves another. But who hit the shot before Fisher's shot? Duncan. Falling to the side. Shaq reaching out like he's trying to grab a burger and a pina colada, and his pull back in Orlando in the offseason with his uncle. And Duncan hits the shot, and it's like, oh man, game five. The Pistons are already taking care of their business in the Eastern Conference. It's going to be the Lakers and the Pistons again for a rematch, is how it felt. Duncan, there's no more fundamental like him. There won't be. It's not coached. It's not taught. Not on the AAU level. I've been connected to AAU all my life. It's just not taught. It's all threes. And listen, some of it is exciting basketball. And sometimes you do kind of have to just get used to what's being played. Doesn't mean I have to like it. Quick sidebar, if you look at baseball, six no-hitters already. What'd you guys do to the ball? I get it. Keep the runs down. Make it more competitive. Stop all this crazy analytical crap. But we still want to see some hits. We still want to see some home runs. And it's six no-hitters. Pitchers are just dealing. But we know you did something with the ball. But here's the thing. Now you can't even change it. You have to go through this season with this. We're probably going to have 9 to 12. Over under 9 no-hitters. I'm going over because we're already at 6. It's kind of easy bet, right? Speaking of bets, another quick sidebar. New York Giant fans, plus 375. Plus 375 on the Giants to win the NFC East. Put 100 down. It's $4,700. Think about it. Think about that. Put 100 down, and you can walk away at 4,700. Giants almost won that division. I don't trust Dallas. Even with Dak coming back with the weapons and the contract, even when he wasn't hurt and he was playing last year, I think they were 3-3 or 2-4. They were 500 or below team. I don't trust Dallas. Washington doesn't have a quarterback. You get some weapons back. I love the Tony pick out of Florida for them to play the slot there with the Giants. And with Shepard, you get Saquon back. They have a great defense led by Jabril Peppers on that back end. The trade for Odell Beckham from Cleveland, they get Peppers in that trade out of Michigan. He's a player. And they're using him in a return game. But you can use Tony in a return game now too. So you don't have to use that for him. You can stick him right there. Let him play that rover. Let him play that Batman type style of a position of defense. That rover. What else they call it? They call it the hitman position. Some people call it the rover, the hitman position. The Batman position. I've heard it called the Batman position, which I really like because I'm a Batman fan. So when I heard that, I said, ain't that somebody calls that the Batman position? Love it. But just another quick sidebar. 100 bucks, 375, get you 4,700. And I would take that bet right now, and I might just, it's 100 bucks. To make almost 5 grand, I'll do it. For a team that I trust with Saquon back, and they almost won that division, they play hard. And I was on the Giants bandwagon after like week 6 or 7. They came out here to L.A., and as in a game against the Rams, that the Rams should have blown them off the field. The Rams were rolling. The Rams should have blown them off the field, and they didn't. And that's because the Giants, they played hard. Their defense played hard. They wrapped up. They tackled. They blocked hard. They just didn't have the weapons. And they lost that game 19-7 or 19-6 or something like that. But from that point forward, I said, okay, that's it. They play hard. Ain't a bad team, but they play hard. You can win some games, and they did, and they almost won that division. Quick sidebar bet. But back to Kobe, Garnett, and Tim Duncan. He's talking about Tim Duncan. If you think about his numbers, 1,300 games, almost 1,400 games, career 19-11-3 guy. We all know about the 5 championships, 19 years in the league, 15 All-Stars, 3 times Finals MVP. He won the All-Star Game MVP also once in 2000, and he's a 2-time regular season MVP. Even if you go back and you look at what he did at Wake Forest, which is tremendous, you played 4 years, but remember, one and done is the thing now. Nobody plays 4 years. Duncan's not only never going to be seen in the NBA, Duncan's never going to be seen in college. We'll never see a Tim Duncan in college again. Not just the NBA. At Wake Forest, he was a 16-12-5 guy. He had over 30 games in all 4 years where he played 1,000 minutes or more. And he had over 100 blocks all 4 years at Wake Forest. And they're only playing 29 to 32 games. And he had over 100 blocks all 4 years at Wake Forest. In his finals appearances in 99, 03, 04, 07, 14, he went 28-14, 25-17, 20-14. The 20-14 year in 05, he's being guarded by Rasheed Wallace. Notice how those points drop down. Rasheed Wallace is one of the best post defenders this league has ever seen. And he never really got the full-time credit for it. Rasheed Wallace is a big reason why the Lakers needed that comeback in Game 7. And in that series went to 7 games against Portland. Rasheed Wallace tore them a new asshole in that series. Excuse my language. Sorry, that slipped out. But he did. Rasheed Wallace was killing Robert Horry. He was killing Samaki Walker. He was killing Shaq. They could do nothing with Rasheed. And at that point, At that time, Rasheed had put the jumper into his game. Like, we'll never see a Rasheed Wallace. That's who DeMarcus Cousins was supposed to be. DeMarcus Cousins was supposed to be Rasheed Wallace. But in that 05 year, 20-17, in 07, he was a little older, 18-11, that was the revenge year against the Miami Heat because Ray Allen saved LeBron and the Heatles' asses the year before that. Well, he didn't save them as much as Kawhi Leonard and Ginobili need to make free throws down the stretch. That's what really set that game up, which isn't talked about nearly enough. We are always talking about how Ray Allen got the shot off and off the rebound from Bosch, but Ginobili and Leonard missed free throws to set that whole thing up. And that's where that game was lost. So you get the revenge year coming back. And then in 14, 15, and 10, but at that point, he was the older Tim Duncan. They had some younger players on the team. In the 97 draft, he was there with also some other, I don't know about Hall of Famers. T-Mac's a Hall of Famer. He was picked number 9 overall, but I don't ever view T-Mac as a Hall of Famer. I'm still trying to figure out how he got in. I love Grant Hill. But Grant Hill, Hall of Famer, I mean, he had the ankle injury. It happens. I don't believe we're allowed to do Hall of Fame and go, well, they would have, or well, she would have, or well, he would. I don't think we should do that. It's got to be what the hell happened. It's got to be. It can't be anything else. We have to stop adding all these things into criteria for Hall of Fame. In the NFL too, maybe one or two guys can get that pass, but, you know, why isn't Penny Hardaway in the Hall of Fame? Because Penny was doing it. And then he had the microfracture in the knee, and he was just never the same explosive player ever again. Larry Johnson, Jamal Mashburn, I mean, I can go on that microfracture. Back in that day, before technology caught up, you get that microfracture, never the... I think it was Larry Johnson say the crossover explosive jump dunk, drive dunk turns into the crossover pull-up jumper. And that's hard for guys to have to deal with who are used to being able to cross you, slip through somebody, and then rise up and dunk on you. Now they have to cross you, two dribble, pull-up jumper. That's a lot mentally to have to deal with, to have to change your game, and you're never the same player again. But we have to stop changing these criteria for Hall of Fame. But in the 97 draft, Duncan went number one. Chauncey Billups has a finals MVP, won the finals with the Pistons. I don't think he's a Hall of Fame player, but very good player in that draft. And then number 13, Derek Anderson. So it wasn't a great draft, but Duncan was number one overall by far. And that's because he was a big. He was a seven-footer who could shoot, defend. Put the ball put his back to the basket and put the ball on the floor. He had the bank shot. He'd dunk on you. He'd hit the jump hook on you. He'd block you. Like, Tim Duncan never took a charge. He tried to just block everything. I don't think I've ever seen Tim Duncan take a charge. And then he kind of reminds me, I've always compared Tim Duncan to Derek Jeter. You know, without, of course, dating all the, you know, the celebrity chicks and stuff. He was married. You know, and then got divorced, I believe, and now married again or whatever the case may be. I don't like to talk about people's personal stuff in sports too much. But He just got it. He was like Derek Jeter. He just got it. Show up, win games, win championships, and you're going to get all that other stuff on the side. And you can do it real quietly. You don't have to be the loudest guy in the room. You don't have to be the biggest guy around. You can do it real quietly and actually, I don't know, have a great career, be a legend, go to the Hall of Fame. That's why I think, Duncan's a Hall of Famer. I mean, excuse me, Duncan's a legend. Before we go on to Kobe, we're talking about Garnett. Garnett was the guy that came into the league that you saw, if you remember the high school highlights from Farragut Academy, where he went to school from South Carolina, but went to the academy in Chicago and played there. If you remember those highlights of this lanky, dark, ball-headed kid who just could dunk and could run and can jump. And it was just like, God, I don't know if I've seen that before. I think he was that guy that had that intensity, that had that attitude to match the height and this lankiness. And Garnett never got big. Garnett never got, you know, muscled up. And he was, that was his frame. But he played at such a high intensity pace and was so strong, even for a leaky guy, but was long, developed the jump shot that he could release high. Nobody could block it. He was going to be there for you on defense. I think I got a crazy stat here where he played 80 games 8 times in 10 years. In his first 10 years, he played 82 games. 80 games, excuse me, played 80 games or more. His first 10 years in the league, 8 times. That's durable. For a lanky guy, for a guy that wasn't as muscular and built and spends $2 million on his body every year type shit. You know what I'm saying? HGH. Yeah, I said it. HGH. I'm trying to tell y'all right now. Trust me. HGH. But Garnett was that kid that, you know, he was the kid. That's what they call him, the kid. And then that became KG. And then he gets drafted to Minnesota, that is a doormat franchise. Even before he got there, they were nothing. What was the NBA even thinking putting a team there? That's hockey and football land up there. They don't care about basketball up in Minnesota. Maybe for the Gophers, but that's only kind of really when they're good. Go turn their games on and just tell me if it's sold out. Go turn their games on. People in that time of year, they're going to watch the Minnesota Wild. It's right there on the border of Canada. You got a lot of Canadians come down and live in Minnesota. And vice versa, a lot from Minnesota go up and live in Canada. It's just, it's not, it, basketball is not it. It's hockey and football. Football's it everywhere, so it doesn't matter. But it's hockey and the Vikings. So I guess it is football, right? Not just the Gophers. But they love their Vikings there. Their Vikings games are sold out. But what was the NBA even thinking about putting a franchise there? Look at them now. Like, they've only been good one time. And that was with Kevin Garnett. And Kevin Garnett played up there 1,400 games. He was a 17-10-4 guy. Shot 49% from the field, 80% free throw shooter. Super soft. That was Duncan's knock. That was my one knock on Duncan, is that Duncan wasn't a great free throw. I think he was pretty bad, to be honest with you. I believe Duncan was like 60-something percent from the free throw line. Yeah, 69%. 69.6. Let's give him 70 so it just sounds better. That's just not, but he did so many other things well. It's like LeBron. LeBron's a career 70% free throw shooter. Can't shoot free throws. Shaq is a career 56% free throw shooter. Ben Wallace is going to the Hall of Fame, deservedly so. He's like a 49% free throw shooter. These guys couldn't hit free throws to save their life. But Garnett was solid from the free throw line. 80%, 15-time All-Star, won the championship with Boston. Anything's possible! Raynell hates that because she's a Laker fan. She thought it was over the top. She hates that. She hates that clip. I, you know, you got to have your finals clips, right? You know what I'm saying? Magic Johnson, yeah, yeah. Isaiah Thomas, heaven must be like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you got to have those, you got to have those moments. Rudy Tomjanovich, never underestimate the heart of a champion. When he's getting the choice, like, you got to have those moments, right? And I think Garnett, that was, and it could have been, you know, created, anything's possible. He knew that'd be played forever, and it will. It'll be played forever. Through the finals, forever, that'll be played. Kobe's lob to Shaq, and the final highlights, when they're showing all, when the finals are coming on, they're showing the highlights flashing across the screen, that'll be played forever. Him jumping into Shaq's arms, Jordan throwing the fists, crying with the trophy. These things, they're organic. The Garnett, anything's possible one might have been not so organic. 5-time total rebound champ, 9-time All-Star, 10-time All-Defensive player. He was going to be there for you on the defensive end. 12 years. And then he did it. He won Defensive Player of the Year when he went to Boston. All right, I'm not the 22, 23-point guy, 24-point guy night anymore. No problem. But I'm going to play this D, though. P2, Rondo, Jesus Shuttlesworth. Y'all just locked out. Anything coming here, I got it. And he played with that heart all year long. And it led him to a championship. In the Western Conference Finals against the Lakers that I've already mentioned when they lost in 6, he did go 24-14-4. You know, he did his job. Going to get Shaq and Kobe and Phil Jackson. It's not easy to do. In the 08 finals, he went 18-10. Also dedicated, man. 39 minutes a game. Like, he wasn't coming off the floor. It was an example of a guy wanting to finish the job. He wanted to finish the job. He didn't want to be on the sideline, jumping and fist pumping and waving. No, no, no. Leave me here to the end. And that's what he did. His class, Garnett's class, is some player. I mean, Steph Marbury, Vince Carter, P2, Chauncey Billups, and Antoine Jameson. So Sharif Abdul-Rahim, Robert Traylor flailed out. He couldn't keep his weight down. Sharif Abdul-Rahim out of LSU went to the Grizzlies. The Grizzlies have been bad forever also. I think they may have had one decent year. And then this year they're fighting for the eighth seed to get in the playoffs. And your reward is the best record in the NBA against the Utah Jazz. I still think that's a series, though. Dylan Brooks, sidebar. Dylan Brooks out of Oregon, whoo. He's NBA, he's NBA made. He's NBA made. You can go ahead and put him on that. He's NBA made. He's ready. So we're talking Kobe Bryant, Garnett, Duncan. Last of the legends here with the Hall of Fame. So Garnett, like I said, loved his career. Even in other series where they got deep into the playoffs, another series against the Lakers in 2003, he went 27-16. In the series in 2002 against Dallas, went 24-19. 24-19 in a six-game series. So he had some great moments in his career, got the championship, couldn't do it in the Western Conference, but at that time, you're battling Kobe and Shaq, you're battling Portland, you're battling Sacramento, you're battling Phoenix, you're battling the Spurs, you're battling the Mavs. Like, it's hell. It's hell in the Western Conference. And Garnett just couldn't break through, got it over in Boston. So now we'll finish up the Hall of Fame stuff with my guy. I'm gonna try to get through this. Without getting emotional. Y'all know how vanilla dudes do we be. What y'all say about light-skinned black guys? We're emotional, right? But no, Kobe Bryant. If Jordan can hold together, I can hold together. Kobe Bryant goes into the Hall of Fame. We knew this was going to happen. We knew this was a foregone conclusion after year three in the league. You just knew he was going to be Hall of Famer. 25-5, 45%. Career, which Chris Broussard, my good friend from Fox Sports Radio and The Odd Couple, you can catch him and Rob Parker 4 to 7 Pacific Time, Monday through Friday on iHeartRadio and Fox Sports Radio, The Odd Couple. That's Chris Broussard and Rob Parker. Chris Broussard and I were debating about Kobe one time. He shot it out of his mouth. Kobe Bryant never even shot 45%. I'm like, yeah, he did. What are you talking about? Shot 45% five, six times in his career. Yeah, he shot 40, some 43, some 44. Kobe took a lot of shots, all right? But when you can shoot that many shots and shoot at that percentage and still do what Kobe Bryant did, I'll take it. You know, fourth all-time in scoring. With all the injuries, man. With all the injuries Kobe be, without the, all the injuries Kobe went through, Kobe would be, he might have the scoring record. And Dell Harris being an ass and not realizing what he had when he first got the Laker job and was the coach of the Lakers and had Kobe on the bench behind Eddie Jones. How'd that work out? That's all I want to ask people. How did that work out for you? Please tell me that. The five championships, 18-time All-Star, 2-time scoring champ, 12-time All-Defense, same as Garnett, 4-time All-Star MVP, won MVP 1 year. In 08, which I'm still is, that's why the MVP means nothing to us. Why anybody debating about it or any player complaining and bitching and pissing and moaning about it, you're whack. Like when LeBron went after it with the press last year, it's weird how y'all vote, blah, 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 bro. It's not even, you trying to stack them just for your own narrative. You're not trying to stack them because you really want them. You just want this narrative that you're better than Jordan because you're just that type of narcissist and you feed it to all the other crap that the people say about you and pass. Y'all know how I feel about LeBron. We don't need to go there. This ain't a LeBron show. But Kobe only has the one MVP, 15-time All-Star, 2-time Finals MVP. In 07, the 07 year, that's the 35-point year. That comes with the 62 and 3 quarters against the Mavs. He used to love lighting the Mavs up. Do y'all remember 44 or 45 points on a Sunday afternoon ABC game when Cuban said that they should amnesty his contract? And then Kobe tweeted, amnesty that, after dropping 45 on them in Dallas and winning. Hitting the game winner with 8 seconds left, 7 seconds left, doing the airplane run back to the bench. Looking at the crowd, Like, and then tweeted, amnesty that. Like, he was, Kobe is such a legend that I've always said this. Kobe Bryant came into the league at the wrong time. If Kobe Bryant had came in with Jordan or before Jordan, there would be no doubt that we would be talking about him as the GOAT. It would be no doubt. Jordan still holds the 6-0, and that's hard to debate against, and it's hard to beat. But if Kobe had to do it against, if he had got his 5 with Jordan 6, like during that run, it's like, hey, because when Jordan won, nobody won. LaJuan got 2. Gary Payton couldn't get 1. Reggie Miller couldn't get 1. Ewing couldn't get 1. Stockton couldn't get 1. Malone couldn't get 1. Kemp couldn't get 1. Shaq couldn't get 1. Penny couldn't get, nobody could get 1. Once Jordan and them showed up, Pistons got their 2. Lakers and Celtics and Philly kind of steals one in there in the 80s. But it's the Celtics and Lakers through the 80s. Celtics won 3, Lakers won 5. That's 8 of those years. Pistons stole 89, Philly stole 83. That's it. Jordan locked down the early 90s, had the early and the mid to late 90s on smash. LaJuan and Ewing and Shaq and Penny get the limelight for 94 and 95, and then they're never heard from again. Penny and Shaq had to wait for Jordan to leave. And then they not only had to wait for Jordan to leave, they had to get Phil Jackson. They had to add Phil to that. So it wasn't just ready-made, show up, we going to win some championships. But the amnesty that comment was just dope. That's the year, 07. 81 points, like I said, the 62 and 3 quarters. It went 35, 7 and 6 that year. I mean, he was just one of them. Like, Kobe did everything that season. 27 points 9 times. LeBron just has some record of like 17 years in a row. And that's impressive. Like, I'm not going to try to knock that one. That one's impressive. Kobe did it 9 times. Kobe took 26,000 shots. When I read that, I'm looking for stats. I'm looking for tidbits. I'm searching around. And I find his shot attempt total. 26,000 shot attempts. I don't know if I've done anything 26,000 times other than talked in my life or taken 26,000 steps. What have you done 26,000 times in your life? Put that into perspective of how many shots. Listen, he's third all time. Kareem's number 1, Malone's number 2. Hey, for all of you, Kobe shoots too many guys. It shows how the analytics are stupid, and it shows how we let way too many nerds and fanboy and jock writers into sports talk radio and TV. Guess who's number 4 in shot attempts and is probably going to pass Kobe Bryant? Yes, you guessed it. You win. Ding, ding, ding. You're king. You're self-proclaimed king. LeBron James is 4th all time with over 25,000 shots. So did Kobe really shoot a lot? I'm just trying to figure out. Somebody let me know. Just call me 860-614-8257. Just call me. I got the phone. Yeah, the phone right here. Got the phone right here. Yeah, call me and let me know. And Kobe still shot too much. This is why I used to argue with people about that stupid, he's ball hog. He shoot. The term is shooting guard. The word shooting, it's in the position. It's almost like, yeah, you're a short order cook. Why I got to cook all this food? Well, the word cook's actually in your title position. So it's probably one of the main things that you have to do. I'm just spitballing here, right? But I thought that was crazy. 26,000 shots. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, Cats number 1. And Karl Malone, the mailman, still without a championship. He don't deserve one, though. Y'all know what Karl be doing. Karl be wilding, man. Shots made. Kobe led the league in shots made. 03, 06, 07, I thought that was a really cool stat that I found. Led in free throws made 2 times in 06 and 07. I thought that was another cool stat. That's just when you're locked in. You're leading the league in shots made. You're leading the league in free throws made. And you still make all defensive first team in all 3 of those years, people. I mean, legend. This is legendary stuff, man. There will never be another Tim Duncan. Not even in college. Nobody stays 4 years and dominates for 4 years. We'll never have another Kobe. That ship has sailed. We'll never have another Kevin Garnett. The league has changed. The league is different now. And that, to me, their Hall of Fame induction, I title it The Last of the Legends. Garnett's good. Durant's good. Kyrie, LeBron, Wade, Melo, Chris Paul, this class of guys, this era, they're ballers. They're bomb. I give them that. They're not those guys. They're not the hitters today in baseball. They're not Griffey. They're not Bonds before this. They're not Bonds. They're not Jackie Robinson. They're not Babe Ruth. They're not Joe Morgan. They're not Pete Rose. They're not. I know we make things easier so numbers can match up, but you gotta don't fail the eye test. Put the numbers away. Close the books. Close the computers. Close the websites and the stat sheets and shit. And just put the tape on. Sometimes in life, you gotta just put the tape on. Close all that other shit out and put the tape on. All right, NFL release. I know I'm late on this because I have not been on the air. So am I really late? Ha! Philosophy right there. I'm taking my philosophy courses in school, so I'd be thinking I'd be philosophizing and shit. All right, listen. The NFL did okay. I was super excited for the schedule release, like everybody else was. My ass was on the online, tweeting and, you know, in chat rooms with people about the schedule. I was so excited. And I have to be honest with you, I was kind of let down. I was kind of let down by the schedule release and the way that they did some of these games. The NFL completely dropped the ball. Completely dropped the ball on the Thanksgiving night game. They completely dropped the ball on Brady with the Bucks, Super Bowl champions, Gronkowski returning to New England. And I called it. I said they were having early October on a Sunday or a Monday night, which means nothing. That game should have easily been Thanksgiving night. What is the biggest family night of the year? Move the mic, man. I got to get up here and talk to y'all about this. What is the biggest family night other than Christmas of the year? Thanksgiving. What is the biggest night that everybody is sitting on their ass eating or trying not to pass out from a food coma of the year? Thanksgiving. People are getting seconds, making third plates, hiding their plate to go in the microwave or the oven so don't nobody eat it. Trying not to look greedy. Sneaking pound cake out to the car so you ain't got to look greedy when you leaving. And you settle in and the NFL gave us the Buffalo Bills and the New Orleans Saints, who have a quarterback who they don't want and another quarterback who's not a quarterback. And that's what they gave us. This was so easy. This was an easy pick. This is low-hanging fruit. This is kick the extra point to tie instead of going for two for the win with 3-7. Tie and go to overtime and beat them. Don't give the game away. This was such an easy pick. Belichick, Brady, Kraft, the Patriots, Gronk. 20 years of winning together. Brady leaves. Before Brady leaves, they draft his replacement. Brady doesn't like it. Goes to Kraft. Kraft tells Bill, deal him. My guy doesn't like a guy on his, over his shoulder. Deal him. I'm still here. I'm still Tom Brady. I'm still the dude with Giselle as my wife, whose net worth is $400 million. My net worth is $175. I win games. I win Super Bowls. Yeah, I defense, kicker. Who's throwing the damn ball around? Who's moving the offense? Me. I'm doing it. Who's taking the pressure from the Giants in two straight Super Bowls right up the gut? Killing our offensive line through the A and B gap. Me. I'm taking it. I'm still here. You guys ain't gonna give me some other players. Don't draft the damn quarterback to sit behind me. Deal him. And they dealt him. What did Tom Brady do? He went and won him another Super Bowl. Yeah, deal that guy. I'll go win you another one. You don't need him. He's about to get cut in San Francisco. They've already drafted his replacement in Trey Lance, who played one game last year. Floss. This is such an easy pick, NFL. How'd you screw this up? It'd have been the highest rated football game in a regular season of all time. And the only reason why I wouldn't have beat the Super Bowl is because people overseas don't celebrate Thanksgiving like we do here. So it'd have been a different atmosphere. But everybody watches the Super Bowl. So it wouldn't have been the Super Bowl. It'd have beat some of them. Wouldn't have been like top 10, I would say. But it would have been the highest rated regular season game of all time. It wouldn't have been close. And you could have got that match. I don't want to hear, well, they did it early, so, you know, everybody's not injured. Oh, my God. Does Tom Brady get injured? Huh? Does Tom Brady get injured? Once. And it's like, does Tom Brady, all you need is Brady. I don't care what's suited up for Tampa that night. I don't care. Gronk can be out. Gronk can get, I don't care. It's Tom. It's Belichick. Look at all the money New England spent in the offseason. You think they're not pissed that he left and then went and won a Super Bowl in the first year? People, come on. The NFL screwed this up. The Bills and the Saints? Are you serious? That's like whoever brought that damn fruitcake, man. Get that. Who brought this? Who brought the fruitcake? I yell it out, too. I ask, who brought? I'm trying to be all secret. Like, who brought the fruitcake? Who brought the fruitcake? No, hey. Hey, who brought this damn fruitcake? Nobody right there. Nobody eat no fruitcake. Where'd you get that from? That looked like that came from the gas station. They got a little basket of fruitcakes there on Christmas and Thanksgiving. People there for last minute shit can buy. Don't bring no. That's what that game is. That game's fruitcake. It ain't peach cobbler. It ain't sweet potato pie. It definitely. I'm gonna make one today. It definitely ain't sweet potato pie at all. That's fruitcake, man. And the NFL dropped the ball on that one. But they did hook us up with some pretty cool games. So let's talk about them. I do like the Bills and the Chiefs as an AFC Championship rematch. And I think rematches from the previous year are good. I know some people don't like them. I do. So the Bills have to go back to the Chiefs. And I like that because you didn't beat them. So they don't have to come to you. If they'd have beat them, then I'd say, you know what? Send them out there. You can send them out there. Send them out there. And let's see if the Chiefs, they did lose the Super Bowl. They didn't win it. They lost. But they won the AFC Championship game at home. And that game was kind of nip and tuck early until the defense showed up and the Bills couldn't move the football. Game over. But let's send the Chiefs to Buffalo and let's see how they do. Nope, you didn't win. So they got to go back there for an AFC game, championship game rematch. So I did like that game. The Bills and the Dolphins at the Bills. The winners of those games take the AFC East. I'm saying it right now. Stamp it. I blow the whistle on my damn self. Y'all thought I forgot about the whistle? We got the whistle. The whistle on the show. I got my gold flag, but my son gets involved. I have a son that crawls around. So my son gets involved in my stuff, and my gold flag is gone. I normally throw the gold flag, but we blow the whistle, though. Because I know that's a bold statement, and man, I normally say I don't like to make predictions that early. I like to go through OTAs, mini camp, training camp, preseason. I don't do a fantasy draft until after preseason. I got to know that these players are going to be on a squad and are going to get some PT in order for me to do a fantasy draft. Quick sidebar, my lineup right now on my chin strap beard, this is a chin strap beard. I'm trying to sew. Normally you get the chin strap. You see I shave it off the side? I kind of wanted to do my own thing. I didn't want a full beard. I can grow that if I want. It'll come all the way down here and all. But I don't want to have to take care of that. I'm like, you know, give me a little something. And I just caught my look on live talking sports on VJs on Sports with Like Conduct. And I saw my shit and I had to admire it. Anyway. But I normally don't like to say predictions early. I'd like to get through the entire offseason before I make any predictions. Guys get cut. Guys get hurt. Players get traded out of nowhere. Speaking of that, we'll talk about Julio too. I know I'm going out of my norm to make this pick. But I look at that division. The Patriots aren't going to be much better than they were last year. Miami, they are turning over every stone. I'm so happy. I'm so proud of my Dolphin. Y'all see the old school Dolphin fitted back there? That's old school. I've had that hat. Hold on. Let me put. I've had that hat for a long time. That's why it's in the studio. That's why it's here. I've had that hat for a really, really long time. But they're turning over every stone. Miami's turning over every stone they can. They have Melvin Ingram in for a visit today. Veteran rush linebacker that played with San Diego all those years. The Chargers that are now the LA Chargers, but was in San Diego. They have Malik Hooker in. Both left without contracts, but I just love the fact they're turning over every stone. What they're trying to do, I can see, they're trying to find a veteran to help steady some of the young positions. They're trying to find a veteran that helps steady that young defense. In the locker room, film study, hanging out, the way you eat, the way you train, the way you really play in this league, the way you get prepared for the games, the opponents you're going to play, the style of opponents you're going to play, the style of offense, what officials. Some of these veterans know the officials. Hey, he likes to call it like this or he likes to call it. All of that shit matters. And it matters a lot. And I think that's why they're bringing in these veterans and they're just talking to them. I think they're going to sign somebody. They're not just bringing all these guys to talk to, but they're going to turn over every rock first before they decide which rattlesnake they want to catch. They're going to turn over every rock first. And I love it because that's what championship teams do. Championship teams turn over every rock. They don't leave no stone unturned. They've evaporated everything. I had a guy, one of my Miami sources today, I was just texting before I came on. I said, they need to be trying to see what's up with the Julio. What is it going to take? And I'm not saying Miami needs to go get him. Just see what it's going to take. He said, trust me, they've already talked. They've already talked to Atlanta. They already know whether they want to do it or not now. They just don't have to. It's very quiet in Miami, and I love that. I love that. Brian Flores from New England all those years, 15, 16 years there. It's quiet. I watched the interviews after the rookie OTA, after the rookie mini camp that they had, and it was some of the most boring, vague answers I've ever seen rookies in Miami Dolphin gear ever give. And I loved it. I loved it. I loved every minute of it because it looked like a championship building team. All the, yeah, man, I'm just happy to be here. And, you know, we're just going to get into the book and learn everything. You know, I had a good practice. You know, I made a nice catches, but, you know, that it's just practice. So it don't mean nothing. If it don't mean anything, then why are you bringing it up? You know how their post-game interviews look? Yeah, you know, we're just into the playbook and starting to get better every play. Do our job. Yeah, you know, just got to do my job and, you know, just happy to be here and, you know, get tighter and get the scheme down, get into the playbook. Yeah, you know, I'm just happy to, you know, do my job. That's what it's like. I watched like four or five of them. And I'm like, you know what? Dolphin fans, oh my God, these kids are so boring. Nah, bruh, relax. Flores is building. You got to build up here first before you can build all of this and before you can even start to play the game. You got to build up here, and I love what they're doing. So, anyway, Detroit and the Rams is another very interesting game because you get Goff and you get Stafford. They get to go back at both their other teams that just traded for them, and they get a crack at their former teams. The Rams are everybody's high button. I live in Los Angeles. They are high out here on the Los Angeles Rams this year. I'm going to try to get a ticket to go down to SoFi. I want to take my son down to SoFi this fall if I can. I don't care what game it is, who it is. I just want to go to that game, go to that stadium with my son, and watch a football game in that stadium. And why not go watch the Rams? I like Aaron Donald. I love Jalen Ramsey. Jalen Ramsey is one of my favorite NFL players. So it would be something to go watch. And Cam Akers, because I always had a crush on Florida State. So Cam Akers is always there, is also there too. So I would love to go down there, down to Inglewood, and go hang out for the day. Go have breakfast, go to the game, go hang out. Go to one of the sports bar. Nah, can't take my son to a sports bar. Buffalo Wild Wings, I could take him there. We go to Buffalo Wild Wings and have some fries. He like French fries. Have some curly fries and some wings. Oh, that's what might be for lunch today. Wings and curly fries for me and my son. Anyway, but that's a game I look at and I say, you know, Stafford is getting back at Detroit, really, is he? I mean, he played there 12 years, never won a division, one playoff appearance, no playoff wins. And what are you getting back at him for? You both wanted to move on. You wanted out, they let you go. Goff is the guy that we're probably going to be getting back because you picked me number one overall. I took you to a Super Bowl. Things kind of fell apart because we had some injuries over the last year or two. And you're just going to jet set me off, not even to like a decent team. You're going to send me to Detroit. You're going to send me. I went to Cal. I went to Berkeley. I was in the Bay, in the area. Yay, area. We could smoke trees, E40, the Warriors, Steph Curry and Klay Thompson and Steve Kerr and all those guys. And then I get drafted in L.A. and I come just right down the 5 Highway. And I'm in Los Angeles and I'm playing at the Coliseum where O.J. ran and where Reggie Bush ran and where Marcus Salah ran and where Ronnie Lott played and where, you know, just so much greatness has come through the stadium. and you're going to send me, and then you open this new stadium, we have COVID, there's no fans, and then the year that all this stuff changes, you're going to send me to Detroit? If I was Goff, I'd be pissed. This is the Goff get back game right here. And you know what? I might just pull for Goff. I might just pull for Goff to get back. The game is here, so Goff gets to come back here. That'll be a game to get some tickets to, man. If I was cool with my brother, me and my brother was on terms, I would actually fly, tell, yo, come out here. Let's go to this game, bro. Let's go to SoFi, watch your Lions. I'll get the, you get out here, I'll get the tickets. Straight up and down. It's me and you, and we take my son. Me, you, my, me and my brother, you and his uncle and nephew, go. Let's go watch the game, bro. Straight like that, man. But that's a great game right there. Packers in San Francisco is a 2019 NFC Championship rematch. And that's what San Francisco ran for 285 yards. Just ran all over the Packers. And they couldn't get back to the Super Bowl. The Packers were. Got to the conference championship game. Been three times now. No Super Bowl appearances for Aaron Rodgers. Missed the discount and double check. So I think that's a big game. And then also, too, is it going to be Garoppolo? Porn star, dating, loving Garoppolo? Or is it going to be Trey Lance? As the starter in that game, going against the veteran, discount double check, Aaron Rodgers. San Francisco gets Trent Williams. They add that the contract, biggest contract ever. Add that left side solidify. So the left side's great. You're solid there. They get Bosa back. They get some of these other defensive backs. They get Stoutmeyer back. They get some players back on defense. They get some of the players back that were injured. Try to figure out the receiving core. I like Deebo Samuel, but I think you need more. I think you got to have some more weapons in that system. And the running back position, I think they need a three down back, which I don't think they have right now. But you have your quarterback for the future, and they're going to move on. I think the defense is good enough to get them to a divisional round. That's a big game. Broncos and Cincy, only because it's Ja'Marr Chase being matched up against Patrick Surtain Jr. That's the Broncos at Cincy. Two young AFC teams, too, and could be really good in the next few years. Depending upon what Denver does at the quarterback position, Cincinnati, I thought, made the mistake of not taking Penei Sewell to lock down. When your quarterback goes down like that, all offseason I'm looking for linemen. I understand Ja'Marr Chase is right there, but one of these receivers is going to bust. One of these quarterbacks is going to bust. You have Fields. You have Lance. You have even Trevor Lawrence. There's no guarantees, guys, in football. There's no guarantees. But Lawrence looks like the goods, right? The best prospect since Andrew Luck. Andrew Luck, best prospect since Marino and Elway. Okay. I don't know if Andrew Luck ever was that, but, you know, 11-5, 12-4 every year, but couldn't get to a Super Bowl in a conference championship. I don't even think got to a conference championship game. Divisional round got wiped. Got wiped in a divisional round against the Patriots with a 44-3 or 41-6 or something like that. Just embarrassed up there trying to play in the cold. Foxborough Stadium in New England, right off the 95, Interstate 95, heading into Avon, Canton, and Boston up in that area. Attleboro. Y'all remember who used to live in Attleboro? Woo! Crazy story. I lived up there when that was happening. But, to me, I think these are two good young teams, Cincinnati, the Broncos. I believe that this will be a really cool matchup to watch. Alabama guy, LSU guy. And you had an LSU quarterback throwing against that Alabama guy and Burrow. So I think that's just a fun matchup. I don't think the game means anything. It's just a fun matchup. Cards at the Texans. DeAndre Hopkins, Jason Watt, they get a shot back at Houston. Will they be also getting a shot back at their former quarterback, Deshaun Watson? We don't know. Because that's a crazy-ass story that's going on that I've not touched. I'm not going to touch, so we're going to move on from that game. Pats at Carolina, that's another good one. And NFL dropped the ball on this one. This should have been Christmas night. They got some Christmas Day games. I think they're playing three. They're playing three Christmas Day games. They could have done this on Christmas Day, or they could have given this to us like the opening Sunday or the opening Monday night game or the second week. Early, nice and early or late. But Cam Newton returns to the scene of 15-1, to the scene of dabbing on everybody, to the scene of going to a Super Bowl, to the scene of winning MVP, to the scene of being the number one overall pick after a national championship and a Heisman, which was preceded before that when he was at Blaine College and went undefeated and won a championship. And before that, he was at Florida backing up Tim Tebow. And he was probably going to win a championship. Back to high school in Georgia where he won a championship. That's the road that Cam Newton took to get to Carolina and everything he did for Carolina. And the thing is, there's no former players there, I don't think, from that era. So it won't be the player, but it'd be that franchise. He's going back to play that franchise. He's going back to go back after that franchise. That is another revenge game. And somebody asked me at that point, I think the game is in late October, early November. Someone asked me, at that point, do you think it's Mac Jones? It better not be Mac Jones. Listen, one of these quarterbacks or one of these receivers are going to be a bust in the first round, guys. They're not going to pan out. It's going to be either Smith or Waddle or Chase or who the Falcons take. I'm sorry, the kid out of Florida. His name is slipping my mind because I got Julio on the brain because I can't believe they're actually talking about trading Julio Jones. And one of these quarterbacks, Lawrence, Zach, Mac, Lance, Justin Fields, Kyle Trask. One or two of these guys aren't going to last. They're going to flame out. If you think about it, in the last 5 years already, Wentz, Goff, Stafford, these guys have already, Trubisky, these guys have all been traded. These guys were all top pick, all top one or two picks. Three picks. I think Trubisky is number two or three. All gone. All gone. All gone. Already. Wentz and Goff went 1-2. Both been traded. 5 years. Gone. Everybody's not going to make it. Everybody's not going to last. One of these guys are going to flail out. But to ask me if Mac Jones is replacing Cam Newton, stop it. Browns and the Steelers. This is late in the year, and I think this is the game I have titled. They put Big Ben and Tomlin and the Steelers out of their misery. The Steelers have been able to last 4 or 5 years, live off of playing the Browns and the Bengals and a Ravens team that was kind of rebuilding and trying to figure things out until they drafted Lamar Jackson. They've been able to really run amok in their division and get a home playoff game. It looks really good. I've been banging on the Steelers for like 5 or 6 years now. If you think about it, the Steelers in the last 5 years have been to the playoffs twice. Their playoffs have ended with home losses of 40 points or more to the Jags and to the Browns. Let me say that one more time because you did not mishear me. The Steelers' last two playoff exits, 3 years, they didn't make the playoffs, only make the playoffs 2 years. Their last playoff exits are to the Browns and the Jaguars at home, giving up 40 points plus in both games. Like franchises, this is the game the Browns will put the Steelers, Tomlin, and Big Ben out of their misery. They'll end this run. They'll end this era for the Steelers. And the Steelers are going to try to figure it out. They don't have a quarterback to replace Big Ben. Claypool's already a diva. It showed with AB there also. Mike Wild, like, there's no more Hines Wards. Hines Ward ain't walking through that door. Jerome Bettis ain't walking through that door. Greg Lloyd ain't walking through that door. Kevin Green ain't walking through that door. Neither is Troy. Neither is Rod. None of those guys are walking through that door. Good luck. I've been calling it for about 4 or 5 years. They're surviving. They're floating. Keeping your head above water. Right there. The water's right there. The water been right there. Then up to the eye just a little bit. Right on the eye. Right there, Gina. Keeping the head above water, Gina. But I think this is the game where the Browns put the Steelers out of their misery. Philly and the Giants, late game. This is November 28th. This is a late division game. This is a feelings game because we know how the season ended last year with Philly trying not to win, as people were saying, so that the Giants would not win the division. Another sidebar I'll give you guys again. If you're not even a Giants fan, if you're just a betting fan, you just want to make a little money, you make a little scratch, $100 on the Giants to win the NFC East will get you $47.50. You have to take that. I don't trust Dallas. Philly's rebuilding. Washington doesn't have a quarterback. I'm taking that $100. I'll put it. It's a plus 375 right now. For Giants to win the division, 100 gets you 47.50, baby. Think it over. Jameis Winston at the Bucks. That's going to be fun. They're going to be able to play the Bucks. Hopefully, he's the starter. It's an NBC game on Sunday night. It's late in the year. It's December 19th. So, I think he'll be the starter by then. I think Taysom Hill starts as the starter. Taysom Hill can't throw the damn football. It's Tim Tebow 2.0. Jameis Winston is inserted, and you got to ride with him for the rest of the year. I don't think it's a great game. I just think Jameis Winston as a starter going back to Tampa is just an interesting game storyline. Colts at the Bills. That's a late November game, too, right before Thanksgiving weekend. Rematch of the division around. Rematch of the division around where the Colts had that game. Phillip Rivers overthrows the wide-open receiver for a touchdown. They get a bad holding call on the third and long where they convert into the red zone, and it knocks them back, and then they miss the field goal. And that was the game right there. That was a 10-point swing. That was the game. I said it live when the game was going in. Some teams, I think, that are in question a little bit for the 2021 playoffs. I don't think the Titans make it. I don't think the Steelers make it. I don't think the Saints make it. I think the Saints are a 6- or 7-win team. The defense can hold them together, but we know every team's going to have an injury somewhere to a big position player. We saw it with San Francisco last year where they lost Bosa. It was just over. And then they watched, Shutterfield, the other defensive tackle? They lost Solomon. They lost Solomon on the other side. That was it. That was the end of their pass rush. You lose two guys like that, that's done. And I don't know if that happens with the Saints. I just don't think the defense is going to be able to hold it together with that schedule that they have this year to where they would get the 8 or 9 wins. They're 17 games now, so that's 6-11. I like 6-11. The Titans, Ryan Tannehill, people are going to stack the box. If I'm playing the Titans, I stack the box every week. I'm going to give up a big play here and there. I know that, but I'm also going to play smart on my defensive back end with the type of zone coverages that I run. But I'm going to – Derrick Henry's not running for 2,000 yards this year. I'm stacking the box, and I'm going to make Ryan Tannehill lead them to the Super Bowl. And I just don't think he can do it because I saw him in Miami up close and personal. Did he have Derrick Anderson? Did he have Derrick Henry in Miami? No. Did he have A.J. Brown in Miami? No. Did he have Davis in Miami? No. Did he have offensive line like that in Miami and Vrabel head coach in Miami? No, I get that. But you're still telling me he can lead you to a Super Bowl? I'm telling you he can't. And I'll put money on they don't make the playoffs. I think the Colts are better in that division. I think the Ravens are much better in that division, especially after they got Bateman from Minnesota. He's the receiver. Once again, some of these top guys are going to flail out. There's always going to be that late first round, third or fourth round guy that we look at and go, God, man, everybody, DK Metcalf, everybody passed him up. Why? Why? What did you not see on film? And I'm not a DK Metcalf fan. I think he's a one-trick pony, to be honest with you. He needs to improve his route running. He needs to improve running the route tree. I don't think that he's a complete wide receiver. I think he benefits from Russell Wilson running around and playing hero ball. I think he benefits from that. I don't know if he's a bona fide top flight, Mr. Everything, number one wide receiver. I think he's a one-trick pony, but he's a good one-trick pony, and a lot of people passed up on him. A lot of people passed up on him, and it's going to happen. I think that happened with Rashad Bateman. If I'm some of these teams that drafted before the Ravens did, like, you know, Tony went earlier than I thought. There were some guys that I looked at and said, you guys are taking that over this receiver right here. Just put the tape on. Put all the numbers and stuff away. Once again, put the Minnesota game tape on. Against the Michigans, against the Ohio States, against the Penn States, against the Michigan States, put the tape on, and he'll show you. Against the Northwesterns, against the Iowas, Kirk Ferentz always has a great defense. They're always right. They're tough to beat in Iowa. They're super tough. A friend of mine, Scott Newman, played receiver at Iowa. Played with Merton Hanks there back in the early 90s. Late 80s or early 90s. My homeboy Scott Newman played receiver there. So it's, you know, you're going to have to show me the Titans can win and they can do it with Tannehill. Ravens coming hard. And if you look at the AFC, it's just so stacked. Chargers, Dolphins, Ravens, Colts. You still got the Chiefs. I think the Chargers are going to be much, much better this year. I love Justin Herbert. I saw him play in person. I went and covered a game up in Oregon and Eugene. Well, covered a game in Corvallis, then drove down to Eugene with my partner, Chris Sylvester, who I called the game with. I did color commentary. He did play-by-play. We drove down to Eugene and went to the game and played against Montana. Played against Montana, University of Montana. And I'm just watching this guy on the field up close and personal. It's like, he's got the goods. This guy's an NFL quarterback. He's got the goods. At that point, Miami's 0-3, 0-4. Miami's looking really bad. People know they're going to get slacked all year long, and they did. Miami started off 0-7, 0-8, and then won 5 of our last 8, kind of turning around a little bit. And then that's what Flores has built up now, trying to take us to the next step. But I saw Justin Herbert play, and at the number 5 pick the Dolphins had, I actually wanted the Dolphins to take Justin Herbert. I have not been sold on Tua. I'm going to, as I said before, I'm going to hold my mouth. I'm going to give him 3-4 years, just like you really should give quarterbacks. I'll give him 3 or 4 years, but he's got to take me to a bowl, man. I got to be getting ready on a Super Bowl Sunday with no plans, no company, no guests, the food I want to eat, the drink I want to drink, the smoke I want to smoke. It's got to be, and I don't need no one around me. I don't need nobody there unless I can go to the game. But if I go to the game, I got to be in the skybox or something. I can't be sitting among the humanoids. I can't. But Tua's got to take me to a bowl. I'm not going to bash him. I'm going to give him every opportunity. I'm going to wait and see what the team does as far as putting talent around him. I will give the front office an opportunity. I'm that kind of fan. I'm getting tired of the MacGyver work. If you guys remember, that's an 80s reference. That's an 80s action show reference. MacGyver was a dude they trapped in a closet, and he'd have a firecracker and some aluminum foil and some glue and a booger. It can make a bomb and blow the door off and get out and shit. Like it's just put anything together to try to win. And I don't. Miami's done that. Dominican Sue, Mike Wallace, big contracts, zero. Dominican Sue was there 4 years. 3 of those 4 years, we were 27th or worse in rush defense. But you're paying your nose tackle $100 million. Doesn't work that way. And I like the way Miami's doing it right now. So set it up properly and give Tua his weapons, and I'll reserve judgment. But I did want Justin Herbert. I thought he was a great fit, and it's shown for the Chargers. I hated that they fired Anthony Lynn because he has so many injuries. You lose Derwin James, who's probably the best safety in football, another Florida State Seminole side crush in college football. And you lose receivers to injuries. You still got Keenan Allen. You still got Hunter Henry. You still got Echo. You still got some weapons there, man. And even at the running back position. And now they're going to kind of mold this thing together a little more. You go get the left tackle. You go get the left tackle out of Northwestern now to put there. I love that draft pick right there. I love that pick for them. Get that solid left tackle there to just go dominate. And you're going to need that in that division in the AFC West. So I like the Chargers making the playoffs. I like the Cardinals making the playoffs this year. I think the Vikings will make the playoffs this year. They got to take care of that secondary. They got to take care of that back end. I think at some point you are going to have another weapon other than going to Jefferson so much. So you got to find some other type of offensive weapon there. Kyle Rudolph has been what he's been from Notre Dame. I thought he was supposed to be better and was going to be better. Just didn't pan out that way. I think the Falcons, if they don't trade Julio, go to the playoffs. If they trade Julio, they're not going to the playoffs. I don't understand the draft pick now. I don't understand. If you're going to trade Julio, I don't understand the draft pick. I don't understand the Kyle Pitts pick now. Why would you not add Kyle Pitts to the tight end they got there, to Calvin Ridley, and now you have Julio Jones? Why? So you're going to take Julio out of that, and now Pitts is supposed to be the number one? Ridley's the one. Is Pitts really your two now? But now if you have Julio on that team, you can't double Pitts. I can double Pitts now. If you're going to take Julio off the field, I can double Pitts and run a nickel zone. I can run a nickel mixed zone man coverage and double Kyle Pitts. It wasn't Atlanta's offense that let them down last year. It was Atlanta's defense that let them down last year. And I'm not saying that draft pick should have been spent on a defensive pick unless it was going to be Michael Parsons, but that would have been a shocker and would have been really high to take him. I had him in my mock draft going 10th to Dallas. And that was just off me saying, you know what, Jerry Jones has got to make the right decision here. Van Der Esch can't stay healthy. We already know what's up with Sean Lee. He's done. You got to fill that spot, man. You can't just go draft defensive backs. And I know a lot of people wanted them to go get a defensive back. But you can't just go get defensive backs if you don't have anybody to rush the passer or anybody that can stop the run. Your defensive backs don't matter then. But I think that Atlanta could go to the playoffs if they keep Julio, not if they give him away. I think the Giants, once again, I got it written down, man, plus 375. Right there, so y'all don't think I'm lying. Plus 375 for the Giants to win the NFC East. And I'm not a Giant fan by far. But I'm a very, very good, profitable betting man. Oh, well, I will be this fall. I'm going to make $10,000 betting in games this fall with college football and NFL football. Guaranteed. I'm going to make $10,000 to $20,000. Cold Cash. I've been studying this shit, man. I'm telling you, this is... we're not going to go into that. Listen, Giants, NFC East, 375 plus. Plus 375. Put 100 down, 47.50. Why wouldn't you do that? Just saying. So, and then there's always a team that's supposed to be good that's not this year. There's always a team that's supposed to be good that's not. It was hard for me to try to find that team. I went division to division. I'm like, okay, Washington's got a great defense, but they don't have a quarterback. I don't know what's up with their running back position, and I'm kind of still shaky on their skill positions as far as pass catchers. Philly, we know, is rebuilding. I like Jalen Hurt, and I like the fact that they team him back up with Devontae Smith out of Alabama, and they get the Slim Reaper, even though that nickname was already designated for Kevin Durant, but they get the Slim Reaper, and they're going to be able to, you know, do some things on offense, I believe. But they still got to fix the defense. They still got to figure out their identity. Is it Dallas? I don't think Dallas is going to be bad, but I don't think they're going to be 13-4. I don't think they're going to be 14-3. I think Dallas is going to be 9-8 or 10-7 because that's what Dallas always is. They're never what they're supposed to be. The year they went 13-3 when Romo gets hurt and they have to play a rookie quarterback, nobody thinks they're going to go 13-3, and they did. All the years that everybody thinks Dallas is going to go 13-3, last game of the year, are they going to finish 9-7? Are they going to finish 8-8? Every year. So I don't trust Dallas. But I don't think they'll be bad. I don't know if people think the Saints are going to be good. I think they're going to be bad, though. But I don't think they're going to... I don't think that people think they're going to be good. So I don't know if I could pick them. A team that I could see falling. A team that I could look at and say, you know what? Something bad can happen in the wheels... could come completely off of this thing. And that's the Seattle Seahawks. I think the Seattle Seahawks are a team that the wheels could come completely off of this thing. With I'm getting Sierra and Russell mixed up. They act so much alike. I was looking like two, like brother and sister. Russell Wilson. Yeah, that's his name. This whole thing that happened with him in the offseason, I don't think it was fluff. I think it was very real. I think that he is that diva that wants in on decisions. He wants in on player personnel moves. He wants to know about what's going on. Wants to be talked to about it. That's fine. I honestly got no beef with that. But the way he went about it and then the way the team went about it and... things just got really messy, and then there was trades. I don't want to be traded, but these are the teams that I wouldn't want to be traded to. So you can always go back and say, well, hey, I didn't want to be traded. They asked me, so I gave them a list of teams. So you can save face with the fan base, which is, you know, just a smart R&B hip-hop move. I mean, I'm sorry. It's just a smart... God, Sierra again. God, next thing I'm going to be saying, Jazzy Fizzle, I'm going to be saying that next. We're talking about Russell Wilson because he acts like Sierra. They almost look alike, too, almost like brother and sister. But I think this thing can fall apart real fast. The defense isn't as good as it used to be. The Legion of Boom ain't coming back through there. You still have great linebacker play, though. I respect that. But, you know, they had linebackers hurt last year. Guys tearing bicep muscles and pectoral muscles and out for the rest of the season. So, yeah, with Bobby Wagner there still solidifying that defense, I think the defense will be competitive, but I think the wheels can fall off because I think the Cardinals are going to be really good. The Rams have all the pieces to be really good. And San Francisco has all the pieces to bounce back and be really good. Somebody's got to take the ass whoopings in that division. And it could be Seattle. And because Seattle... And could you see 6-11? 6-11 for the Seattle Seahawks. I'll pull up their schedule here real quick. We'll do that. I normally don't like to pull up schedules while I'm on a live show, but well, this is an interesting topic. I want to touch this. So I'm looking at let's go. Let's find Seattle here, and let's check out their schedule. So Seattle, NFC West, Seahawks. All right. So, regular season, they start out with the Colts. I say loss. Titans win. Vikings, San Francisco, LA. So, check this stretch out right here. So, just to start the year, if you just really look at this stretch, just to start the year, They're at the Colts. I think that's a loss. They're home against the Titans. I think that's a win. But then they're at the Vikings and at the Niners. They can drop both those games, and now you're immediately looking at 1-3. You're immediately looking at 1-3 with a home Rams game coming up. And nobody loves to chase around Sierra. I did it again. No one likes to chase around Sir Russell. Come on, VJ, get it together. No one likes to chase around Russell Wilson more than Aaron Donald. Nobody likes to chase that guy around more than Aaron Donald. They sacked him like 12 times last year in three games. They just teed off on his ass and went up there, won a playoff game, which I predicted, three-point spread. And I said on my show on live air that the defense would score and they had a pick six in the second quarter. I cashed in that day with the Bally Sporting Book. I had a great day that day. At the Steelers, I don't think the Steelers would be great, but you are going cross-country to play that Steelers team. Saints at home, Jags at home, that could be two wins before a bye. But then you're at the Packers, and then you go against the Cardinals and Washington at Washington, so you got to fly back east again and play a great defense. Before the Niners, Texans, Rams, another defense, Bears, another defense. Lions should be a win, and you finish on a road in a division against the Cardinals. I see 7-10. I see 7-10. Rams sweep. They lose to the Bears. They lose at Washington. They lose at the Packers. Lose at the Steelers. Lose at the Niners. Lose at the Vikings. Lose at the Colts. That's 7-10 for Seattle. So there's my team. There's my team that I think people would think that would be good, but something's going to go wrong. The wheels are going to fall off. It's going to be the Seattle Seahawks. And we'll get more into football. We'll get more into the schedules and the picks. And I'll wait. I don't talk a lot of football. I normally don't do a lot of radio during the summer because there's no football and basketball to talk about. And you can only talk about baseball so much. And you got golf and tennis and some of the other international sports. So that's normally when I'm into other things and handling, especially this summer with being in school and then going to barber school to open up my barbershop for my son, to leave my son, to leave camp. So I normally don't talk a lot of football during the summer. I'll get in as much as I can. But for the next month, it's just going to be basketball, 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 and NHL playoffs. So, and speaking of basketball, great games last night, great games over the weekend. And let me just say this about the NBA. I know I bang on the NBA. I've always banged on the NBA. I don't have a beef admitting that I've banged on the NBA. But this weekend was very well done. The play-in tournament, I think they should stick with. I think the play-in tournament is good for the league. I know it was really good the other night because you have Steph and LeBron. But I think that you can say, look what Ja's doing. Look what Morant's doing. With Dylan Brooks. Dylan Brooks, guys. Once again, talk about a kid that stays in school. He comes into the league. Dylan Brooks is about to be like Draymond Green. You know, he's going to put a better score. I think he's going to be like Draymond Green, but a better score. He's going to get a lot of technicals. He plays really hard. He fouls a lot. He's led the league in fouls like 2 years. So he fouls a lot. And I believe that he's going to be a player, though. He's going to be a pretty damn good Draymond Green type player. But I think you should leave the play-in games alone. Give us at least all the way down to the 10th seed for teams that can get in. And listen, we got the right team in, right? If you really think about it, we got the right team in on both sides. Washington almost pulls that thing off. If it's not for Tobias Harris, Philly is down 0-1. And tonight's games are going to be dope too. Phoenix Suns, that's a complete, I have to admit, I haven't watched a lot of Phoenix, but I did predict on here, VJ's on Sportsmanlike Conduct. Y'all know I'll be ahead of the curve. I did predict on here they would win 50-plus games this year. They won 51. I just love the moves that they made. And Chris Paul, I'm not a Chris Paul fan, but wherever he goes, he will get you to like 49, 50 wins. He's going to give you that much. Chris Paul's going to give you that. So that was something else. That was another prediction that I cashed in on this year too. And we'll talk about MVP, Sixth Man of the Year, which should be Derrick Rose. MVP, Steph had a shot. I know he's a finalist. He had a shot, but he didn't get to the playoffs. So he can't win it. That's just me being real. And I'm a Steph guy. I like Steph Curry. But you can't win if you can't win MVP if you don't make the playoffs. Now, 7 seed, 6 seed, 8 seed, but I don't care about none of that. But if you don't make the playoffs, it's like you can't win finals MVP if you lose. I don't care. I know they gave it to Jerry West one year when they lost, but they shouldn't have done that because now it sets a precedent. Well, they gave it to Jerry West. Nope, no player ever have a Super Bowl MVP on the losing team? Ever? Ever have a World Series MVP on the losing team? You ever have golfer of the year who never won any majors? Tennis player of the year who didn't win any Grand Slams? NASCAR driver of the year who didn't win any races? Like, you can't. It's just the rule, man. It is what it is. But you do have sixth man of the year. I think it should be Derrick Rose. MVP probably is Jokic, even though, hey, listen, let me tell y'all something. Portland, man, I've seen this from Portland before, and I want to see Portland go deep. I really do. Because Dame is what, if Portland could somehow win the championship this year, Damian Lillard would have single-handedly saved the NBA. He would have single-handedly saved the NBA if they could somehow, some way, win a championship this year. Damian Lillard would single-handedly save the National Basketball Association from the depths of super team fluff, internet, social media, load management, just BS low rating, failing, falling ratings that the NBA is today. But this past weekend and this past week, all the way back to the playing games, was really good. I got to tip my hat. I'll give the NBA props for the job that they did. And the players, the coaches, everybody. The call, the teams, the color commentators, and the play-by-play guys have been great. Sidelines have been great. Like, everything's been great these last 5 days with these playing games and the playoff games. So, yesterday, watching the Knicks and the Hawks game, I think was probably the most entertaining game and the game that just felt like late May playoff basketball. Now remember, it started late this year. So we're technically supposed to be in the conference finals by now. And we're only in game one of the first round. So this is going to run until the end of June. Early July, does it run until 4th of July possibly? I'm not sure, but that would be interesting if it did. You ever sit and watch an NBA Finals game on 4th of July? Put all the food on the grill? Food on the grill. That's what we're doing for lunch today. I'm sorry. That's what my son and I are having for lunch today. I'll go get some grub and throw it on. I'll go get some grub and throw it on the grill. But the NBA season started late. So right now we would really be in conference finals. But we are in the first round, game one. And watching the Knicks yesterday, oh my God, what a feeling of just, you know, 15,000 fans. They snuck some more in there. It wasn't just 15,000. That place was loud. The organ playing, the defensive chant, Derrick Rose balling, Burks balling, Thibodeau over there coaching his ass off, Nate McMillan over there coaching his ass off, and Trae Young still in the show. And like me, mugged the crowd for a minute. Hits the game winner. And I'm all the way up talking. Yes. Give me more of it. I need that. And it needs to be organic. None of this made up stuff, man. No more acting. LeBron fell on the floor again yesterday. Oh my God. Oh, my arm. Oh, now I can't see. And I have one arm. Look what I'm doing. I have only one arm, and I can't even see, and I have an ankle. Oh my God, look what I'm doing. Welcome to Kobe Bryant's career. Except for Mike and Kobe wanted you to think that they were healthy when they're not. LeBron wants you to think he's hurt when he's not. That's the difference. Bam! Slam dunk, man. The conversation of Kobe, LeBron, and Jordan is over. It's over. It's really been over. It's been the stupidest and dumbest conversation that we've had in sports and sports talk radio and TV for the last 15 years. It's been the dumbest topic. Is LeBron with Kobe not even close? It's not even Magic. How y'all putting him over Magic? How y'all putting him over Bird? Bird was white. Like, the white boy that was 20, what was it, 25 and 12? 24 and 12? Other than Steph Curry, probably the greatest shooter, him, Steph, Dirk, right? Ray Allen? Reggie was a good three-point shooter. I know, you know, we should do that on the show. Top shooters, top 10. Top 10 just pure shooters. Because I could give you Steph. I can give you Steph's daddy. Dale used to light it up. Mitch Richmond can light it up. Dana Barrows was a shooter. Dale Ellis was just a flat-out shooter. There's some guys that never get talked about that were just flat-out marksmen from anywhere on the floor. Rip Hamilton, great shooter. Had the mid-range game on lock. Mid-range was on lock with him. And then, of course, Steph and Clay. And who else today? Steph, Clay, Korver. Korver, slide it up. Korver was a great, Mike Miller, great shooter. Just, there were some guys, man, that could just, whoo, VJ Vernon Husky. Y'all see my form? Look at the backs, man, All right, cool. But, NBA playoffs, Knicks game yesterday, Trae Young steals the show, me mugging the crowd. Another game I thought that was really, really dope and really got an old school nostalgic feeling to it was the Lakers and Suns yesterday. I haven't seen a Suns crowd like that since the Nash and D'Antoni days, man, with Stoudemire and Marion and Grant Hill and Barbosa and those guys that was winning 57, 58, 60, 62 games a year and just running people out of the gym but couldn't play any defense in the regular in the playoffs and never could get to the finals and win a championship. It was just a really good regular season team, but that arena used to be rocking. And it's back now. Sidebar, I didn't know it was named Taurasi Way. That's what's up. I ain't mad. It could have been Barkley because he did take him to a finals there, but Taurasi won championships there. Yeah. And she's all-time leading scorer, I believe, in WNBA history. So, okay, never mind. Forget what I was about to say. It should be Taurasi Way. But they announced it yesterday and said, you know, right down from such and such boulevard and you take a left one to Taurasi Way. I'm like, oh, they named it after Diana Taurasi. She is a beast. Her Cheryl Miller, two best female players of all time, I would think, right? All right, anyway. I wanted to say Candace Parker, but I'm like, because there's Cheryl Swoops, Cynthia Cooper, some other women that were pretty damn good. That'd be another great topic, too. The top 10 women players, women basketball players, WNBA college of all time. Oh, let's do that. Let's set that up for later this week. Let's show some love to the WNBA, man. Show some love to the ladies. We're going to promote that one. We'll promote that one. Let's get some women on here, too, to talk about it, too. So, but the Lakers and Suns yesterday, great game. Chris Paul hurt again. LeBron flopping and flailing all over the place. Him and Chris Paul back and forth. That checkout that he did, too, that hip check he gave LeBron, you can see the friendship kind of went out the window. Because that was one of them Chris Paul kind of cheap shots. Because he felt like LeBron came in and hip checked him on his neck earlier in the game. They tried to say he bumped into Cam Jordan. No, he didn't. LeBron came in for that rebound and hip checked his ass and hit him up in the. And that was a late reaction. I've had a stinger like that before. It doesn't happen right away. It's a late reaction. It takes a minute for the nerve to send that down. Once that nerve closes up, then it's like, oh, shit, what is that? What the, oh my God, what is going on? That's what happened with Chris Paul. And that hip check box out on that free throw, I thought that was, and he kind of looked down at him too, man. It's like, oh, nah, you nah, bro. I've been watching you since high school, Chris Paul. I see how you do. I've been watching you for a minute, Chris Peasy. So I see how you get down. So that had a feeling of a little personal get back to LeBron for that hip check he gave him in his neck earlier. But Devin Booker, baller. Aiton last night was balling like Cam off the bench, Tar Heel, for Phoenix that came off the bench was Cam Johnson, played great last night. And they got the win, 9-point win, pretty much led. Once it got the double digits, it was the 12, it was the 15 at one point, it was the 13 at one point. Once they got it up there, it stayed up there pretty much the whole game. AD, I think, will come out strong tomorrow night. I think LeBron will come out stronger. AD 16, LeBron 18. Or is this just what they are? Is this just what the Lakers are? Let's analyze this for a second. Earlier in the year, I was adamant in saying I thought it was foolish for anybody to think that this team was better than that Laker team last year. And I underestimated that Laker team last year. I severely underestimated that Laker team last year. But this team is not better. Dennis Schroeder's not going to be better than Rondo in the playoffs. Rondo's going to come down the stretch and give you something. Trust me, he will. And we'll talk about Dallas and the Clippers, too. They go back at it again two tonight. Clippers got to get this. That's the game I'm going to have my eyes all over. I'm not doing anything but schoolwork and writing and editing after this for the rest of the day and hanging out with my son. So we watching playoff basketball on the big TV. I'm not watching Mickey Mouse Clubhouse today. I'm not doing it. I'm not watching Achille and me today. I'm not doing it. I'm not watching Dougie. I'm not doing it. We are watching NBA playoff games on the big TV when the games start. And you can just chill and eat cookies and crackers and yogurt and drink juice with daddy. That's what we're going to do. All right? Eat food off the grill. But what I want to say about the Lakers is I just think this is who they are. That team is not better. That team is not better than it was last year. You gave up JaVale. You gave up Dwight Howard. You gave up that length and that athleticism. I know you got Drummond back, but Drummond ain't going to give you nothing on the offense. He's a liability late in games because they could just foul and put him at the free throw line. He shoots below 50%. LeBron, Father Time escapes nobody. TV, media, radio, everybody spent so much time talking about year 15, year 16, year 17. Guys, two of the last 3 years where he's played, there's been no break. LeBron's been hurt. He pulled a groin Christmas, and it affected him the rest of the year. He twisted the ankle, and look at it. There's no lift. But he makes sure he gets a dunk in the game against, against Memphis or against Orlando when he came back. Let me get a nice fast break dunk in, because people, the next morning, well, yeah, he looks great, because on that dunk, he takes a lift. He knows that. He knows you guys are going to say when he takes, and he lifted off of that dunk. It looks so, he had no lift yesterday, and he's had 4 or 5 days off. He had no lift yesterday. Anthony Davis, I think, is just worn on being on the LeBron shadow. I'm telling y'all, I know y'all want to say it's hating, but I'm just analyzing it. Go back to the finals post-game interview when they won it last year and clinched against the Heat. Anthony Davis is standing there, finally in his moment, finally about to get an interview and get some finals clinching post-game questions. And who has the trophies in his hands dancing like this? Getting here, having everybody in the background laugh and giggle, is interrupting the questions, and then he moves into the camera. Go back and just watch the video. Look at AD's face. Kyrie tried to warn everybody. Think about it. The only people who love the guys either working for Clutch, Richard Jefferson, Wade never played, Wade won championships with him, Melo never played with him, Chris Paul never, those are like, you see a lot of other players coming up, oh my God, I love them as a teammate. Kyrie Irving said, get me the out of here. I'm not going to father figure, I have a father. Y'all remember that question? LeBron says he's like a father figure. He's like, I have a father. His name is boom, 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 Irving. I have a father. Like, you can tell that. Nah, don't father figure, bro. Like, you talk crazy. And you're not really about the cause. You're not. I think that's what Kyrie's angle was. Kyrie showed up with the fro. Y'all see Kyrie with... Hey, Kyrie! I've been with you, dog. I'm going to stay with you, Kyrie. I defended you back in January, B. I need you to go get these dubs. Go get this chip. I need Brooklyn to go get the chip. I need Durant to get the chip. I do. I need Durant to get his third. I need Kyrie to get a second. I need Kyrie to get one without LeBron. I'm just being honest with you guys. At least I'm being honest. There's people out there that won't admit you don't want Kyrie to get one without LeBron. Let's talk about that. I'm just playing my position. Just like y'all playing yours, and everybody can have theirs. But there's no lift in LeBron's legs. I actually picked the Lakers to win this series. I have my picks here. Western Conference, Eastern Conference. I picked the Lakers to win this series 4-2. Because I do think that if they are healthy, that LeBron and AD can just take this series over. Kuzma will have some spots. Caruso will have some spots. CP will have some spots. Morris will give him something in a game. Drummond will have a 19-rebound game. And The other games, LeBron and AD can take over and win the game. I have them winning 4-2. Even though they only average 109 points a game, which is 22nd in the league. So the Lakers do go through these scoring spurts where they can't score the basketball. But they were number one in defense efficiency. Now the Knicks were number one in total defense, and because they were number one in like four categories. But the Lakers were number one in defense efficiency. And you got LeBron, you got AD, and then you have the defense. And I thought that was enough, and I still think it's enough that the Lakers will win that series. But not if LeBron don't have no lift, and not if AD's going to give you 16 points. Tomorrow night, AD will have 35. You have 35, 36. LeBron will chip in with 26, 27. They'll win tomorrow night. That Denver-Portland series, I got Denver winning it 4-2, but they better wake up real fast. And you should win. I think Denver's a better team. I think Denver's a better team. Now, I know Jamal Murray might change my mind a little bit and sway me. But Dame Lillard, 29 points a game. And you just got to tell me who else you're going to get. Is it going to be Nurkic or is it going to be CJ? You got to tell me who else you're going to get. We know we're going to get Dame Dollar. But who else are you giving me? Who else is coming along for the ride? The other night, Melo had 15 in the first half, but only ended up with 18. If Melo has 15 in the first half, I need Melo to have like 25 to end that game. And Melo is just a walking bucket, man, that I just love to death. Utah Jazz and the Grizzle. I think Utah wins this one 4-1. I like the Grizzle. They're a young, feisty team. They're Ja Morant's team, though. They're officially Ja Morant's team. The Clippers and the Mavs. This is dangerous for the Clippers. And listen, my chips are all out on the Clippers. I'm all out on the Clippers. I'm all out. Here's the thing, though. I've never truly been all in. I've never truly been all in on the Clippers. I think they have a chance, or I think they had a chance to win a championship. But I've never been all in on the Clippers. But I am now all out on the Clippers. You just cannot lose that game one like that and let Luka go off like that. It's Luka, and he's playing like he's got nothing to lose. And 28-point-a-night game guy this year, almost 30 a night, man. Luka's the deal. Luka's the goods. And PG struggled. Started 1 of 8 from the field. Here we go. Maybe it wasn't Doc. Ty Lue. I always said, not a great coach. You won with LeBron and Kyrie. And you were down 3-1 until the Bogut injury and the Draymond suspension. You were on your way to getting your ass handed into you in 5 and losing that series. And nobody would have called Ty Lue a great coach. You're still the guy in the finals trying to strap up Allen Iverson while he's hanging 49 on you. Him hitting the jumper, step back. You falling and shit. And him stepping over you and looking at you. You're still that guy, Ty Lue. Clippers better be very careful. I have them winning in 7. But you got Kawhi and PG. The Clippers better be on high alert. You better be on high alert. Everybody better show up in this series. Don't let Luka take this from you by his damn self. Denver better wake up. Clippers better wake up. Suns stay awake. Lakers are still super, super good. They're still super, super dangerous. Do not think you got this series because you got that dub last night. Over to the Eastern Conference. I thought the Sixers played well. I thought the Wizards played well. I thought the Sixers just had a guy that can't be guard. They can't be guarded, and Joel Embiid. And the Wizards don't. There's the series. I still think it's a 6-game series. The Wizards will get 2. The Wizards will get 2, but that's it. That's it. Even though they're dropping 116, which is 3rd in the league, and they shoot and they grab the same amount of rebounds, so rebounds cancel out. They average 45 a game, so do the Sixers. Total rebounds a game. So the rebounds are going to cancel each other out. It's going to come down to Russ, his 22, 12, and 12, or it's going to come down to Embiid's 28, 10, and 5. That's what it's going to come down to. And I think Embiid has to take care of the ball. This year, Embiid had more turnovers than he had assists. That's not a stat that you want. The Bucks and the Heat, that's going to be a great series. The Bucks better be on high alert, man. You better wake up. This ain't even the same Heat team from last year. Hero's not that sharp as he was. He's hitting that rookie wall. They got lucky by having them 4 months off. Everybody got lucky. Nobody got luckier than the Lakers. It hurt some people. The Bucks were never the same team again once they took their 4 months off. They showed up to the bubble. They look like a different team. They look like a different team in the playoffs again now. Middleton had to save it the other day, which I don't think Middleton can do all the time. I think he's a B-plus, A-minus guy. I don't think he's an A or A-plus player. I saw him firsthand in Detroit. I still like the Bucks in seven. But they better wake up real fast. Giannis had a great year. 28-11-6. Jimmy Butler, 21-7-7. But Jimmy seems to be a better leader. Jimmy Butler seems to be just a really good leader and mentor and motivator. And you need that in a veteran. The Knicks and the Hawks. I took the Knicks in seven because I just want to see the Knicks go far. Because I think the league is better if the Knicks are far in the playoffs. But last night, you got to do better on defense. You got to do better on defense. You got to do better on that last possession. That throw-in, that was a horrible throw-in to Randle. He doesn't get a shot off. You got to be better on defense where you just let Trae Young drive all the way down to the second stripe on the paint where they stand for the free throws. He gets to the second line and pull up floater, and he's been killing you with the floater. Nobody stops ball. Got to be better, and they better wake up. And they don't score a lot of points. They hang their hat on their defense. 26th in the league in scoring at just 107. The Hawks put up 113, 13th in the league. Once again, rebounds cancel out. About 46, 47 rebounds apiece. So that's going to cancel out. It comes down to your stars. Trae Young, 25, 4, 9. Randle, 24, 10, and 6. Who played better last night? Who hit the buckets when they needed it? Trae Young. Who got the win? Trae Young's team. And then the Nets and the Celtics. This is 5 or 6 for me. Harden with 25, 8, and 11. KD with 26, 7, and 6. Kyrie with 27, 5, and 6. The 90, 50, 40 club. Afro Kyrie. That's Afro Kyrie now. Y'all see Kyrie pick the fro out. I love it. Had it lined up all night. Is he channeling his inner Kobe? His inner young Kobe? Durant, Shaq, right? Right? Harden's Fisher. Kyrie's the Kobe. The early Laker championship teams. That three-peat, this could get real ugly, man, with Brooklyn. I don't see a team. Brooklyn and the Sixers are, I think, what everybody wants to see. And I think that's what we'll get. Nets second in the league at 118 in scoring. Six more than the Celtics at 112. Once again, rebounds cancel out at about 40 a game. Comes down to the stars. No Jaylen Brown. The Celtics played with a lot of spirit the other day. But it was time to just get the ball into the talent's hands. Get this to Kyrie. Get this to Durant. Get this to Harden. That was the difference in the game. So I'll take, I got the Nets 4-2 and 6. I got the Knicks in 7. I got the Bucks in 7. I got the Sixers in 6. I'll take the Jazz in 5. I'll take Denver and the Denver one I think I'm going to be wrong about. I think I'm going to be wrong about the Denver one. If Denver don't wake up. And Melo looks hungry. And Melo looks zoned. Carmelo Anthony looks zoned in. He looks really zoned in. Clippers and Mavs. Clippers and 7, but they better wake up and they better get it tonight. They play tonight. Is that game tonight? Let me just check the schedule real quick. Because I know opening weekend, they run all the games Saturday, Sunday, and then Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, they start to break them up. All right, so Bucks. Oh, there's only 2 tonight? Yeah. So they're going to start to break them up. So we get the Heat and the Bucks tonight. So lucky the Clippers. Clippers got another day. Excuse me, Clippers got another day to think about it. They go tomorrow night. So tomorrow we get 3 games. Brooklyn and the Celtics. Lakers go at it again tomorrow night. And then the Clippers and the Mavs go at it. So both LA teams on tomorrow night. Both at 7 to 7:30. One on TNT. One on NBA TV. Oh, man, this is going to be just outstanding. Even tonight, Miami and the Bucks and Portland and the Nuggets. Two home teams. That better wake up real fast tonight. I think that's high drama. Tonight, I'll take the Heat. I'll take the Heat, and I'll take Portland. Let's see what the spread is on the games tonight, too. We'll throw some spread money out there. You guys want some spread picks? Let's get some spread picks and some spread money going out there tonight. So, Bucks are favored by 4.5. I'm going to take the Heat. The Heat are at plus 4.5. Trailblazers are underdogs by 2 points. So if you're looking at the Miami Heat, the money line with the Heat is 270. So 100 gets you 270 back. Put up 100, you get 170 back and you're 100 back. So you put up 100, you walk away with 270. If you want to do a bet like that, just on the straight up money line. If you want to take the point spread, take the Heat with the point spread at 4.5. At 4.5, 100 gets you, 100 gets you, 100 gets you 95, so you get 195 back, get your 100 back plus 95, so I'll take that. I just put 100 on, see, I got my little app right there, so I just put, when it's blue, it'll let you know you put the money up. So, y'all see the blue right there for the Heat, so that means the money's up. The over and under in that game is 223. Game one went in the overtime, so it went over that. This one, I think defense, I'm a count on defense to be a little better in this one. I'll take the under on that one. And then let's jump over to this Trailblazer game. This Trailblazer game, the money line is 210. So 100 on that gets you 210 back. So let's put 100 on that on the Trailblazers. And the point spread, the over-under, well, let's do point spread here too. I'm picking Portland to win, so I'll take Portland on this all day. So there we go. So we got Portland on the point spread with a plus 1.91, plus 2, basically. So plus 200 there. Portland the money line on the 210. We'll take that also. And then on the Bucks game, we'll take the Heat with the plus 4.5. And then we'll take the money line on the Heat with the 270. So those would be the bets for the night. Tomorrow, let's see what tomorrow's numbers are. And Vegas already has the numbers out for tomorrow's games. And they do. Celtics, 9.5 underdog. If you want to try to make some money there, might be some bread to make there. Lakers are still favored tomorrow night. Lakers are favored in this series. So the Lakers are favored, and they're favored to win this series. And that's why I went with them 4-2. I just don't, and now Chris Paul's neck and shoulder and trapezius muscles is all jacked up too. So that could be a big problem. That could be a big issue also too. Brooklyn and the Celtics, I like that right there. That 9, that woo. That 9.5 look kind of juicy. I might have to wait till tomorrow night. The money line is 475. Yeah, 100 gets you 475. 475. No, excuse me, 575. Yeah, money line is 475. So you put 100 up, you get 575 back if the money line comes through, if Boston wins tomorrow night. And Boston was in that game, nip and tuck. I just think that once you just, like I said, get the ball to the Stars, get the ball to Kyrie and those guys, you know, they're just a better team. So we'll wrap up today's show, man. I said I wanted to go for about 2 hours, and we are about 7 minutes away from that. I do want to thank everybody for tuning in. So just to recap really what we talked about today, Hall of Fame. Oh, one thing I didn't get to. Oh, two things I didn't get to. So we are going to hit the 2 hour mark. Listen, I want to end the show on this. I'm going to make this as simple as I can, and people can either take heat or not. Leave Kwame Brown alone. Leave that man alone. Y'all better stop playing with Kwame Brown. Let me say it again for y'all, for the people who think that you should actually be messing with this guy. Leave Kwame Brown alone. He's been the butt of people's jokes for so long. You can only kick a man so many times in his life before he wants to react, and he getting personal. If you don't live in a glass house, bruh, if you ain't got no issues, your life is good, I would probably stay away from Kwame Brown. Don't mess with him. He is not for play. Kwame Brown ain't for play. He going at everybody. Stephen A. He done went at Charlamagne. He went at Envy. He went at Matt Barnes. He went at Steven Jacks. Like, he is not playing. And guys like Jalen Rose, I think Doug Gottlieb came to his defense. Chris Broussard came to his defense too, because it's like, and this whole, why I wish you wouldn't get personal. No, it's personal. It's personal. You want to keep shitting on me? You want to keep talking about me? You want to keep trying to, like, play me? No, it's personal. It's very personal. And you got to just leave this guy alone. And he looks like he wants some smoke. Like, you could just look at certain guys and tell, yo, he would the shits and gigs. You might want to leave him alone. And Gilbert Arenas, I've done radio with Gilbert Arenas, like Kevin Hart, LOL, on a spot he did with the Earthquake show. And Gilbert likes to talk.
Gilbert likes to talk and be entertaining and, you know, talk about people. That's just his thing. But you might have talked about the wrong guy here, and I think people need to leave Kwame Brown alone. You guys need to start blaming Michael Jordan a lot more for this and for what Michael Jordan was doing to him and the stuff he's even letting out and telling him. Took him to a Greek restaurant, trying to change him, trying to make him eat Greek food. He said, I went across the street, got my own food, brought it back. They look at me like I'm crazy. I said, you can make it sound like my mama make it. Give me a hard-boiled egg, some cucumbers, and tomatoes. That's how I want my I only eat goat cheese and olives and... Said Michael Jordan had older players coming to practice, hacking them hard and fouling them in college and in practice and beating them up in practice. And Charles Oakley tried to fight him and stuff. They're doing this to an 18-year-old kid. Listen, man, nobody wants to really admit it and say it, but this is a boy. This is along the lines of bullying. This is along the lines of bullying. I understand you got to check a guy out. I understand you got to see what a man about. Got to see what a dude about. That you want to try to win championship with a franchise, but this is starting to look like it went over the line. And Kwame Brown is bringing it out. Everybody knows Jordan's an ass. Everybody knows Jordan's a tough one, guys. I get it. But if you were doing this to an 18 and a 19-year-old kid, man, and let's stop calling him a bus. He played 12 years in the league. That's not a bus. Adam Morrison's a bus. Jimmy Verdette's a bus. Sam Bowie's a bus. Eddie Curry's a bus. Those guys are bus. Sebastian Telfair's a bus. Kwame Brown played 12 years and was a serviceable guy. It's not a bus. So I brought my mom. I moved my mom out the ghetto, out the hood, out the country ghetto. I brought my mom a house on a golf course at 18 years old. Y'all better leave this man alone, man. And that's all I'm going to say. Hey, Kwame. Call me, homie. We can rap. I ain't got no beef. Don't come. I ain't got no beef. And I, you know what? I want to like Matt Barnes, but I be seeing the shadiness, and I be seeing the two-facedness in him by the way he talks and the way he kind of says certain things. He was on the jump and was like, you know, I don't know. I wasn't even there. You know, I ain't got nothing to do with it. But they got in his car and was like, yeah, you got my joint in your mouth. Come on the show. Listen, he's not going to come on the show. It's going to be too vital. It's going to be too pretentious. Y'all going to be fighting. That's going to be a fight. He got security and all that stuff show up. We don't need that. If y'all ain't going to really just talk about it, do a Zoom or some shit. Do a Zoom or a StreamYard. Y'all two don't need to meet up and talk. That don't need to happen. He looked like I said, he looked like he want all of the smoke. And I just don't think that's something, a tree that you want to shake too hard and see what falls out. Y'all leave Kwame Brown alone and talk about somebody else, some of these other dudes that were real bust. So, that'll wrap up today's show, but really quick wrap up about today's show. Hall of Fame, Duncan, Garnett, Kobe, last of the legends. They let too many people into the Hall of Fame. Move over to the NFL scheduling. Some good matchups, some great matchups, some okay matchups. Bad Thanksgiving night game with the Bills and the Saints. NFL completely dropped the ball on Tom Brady going back to New England with the Bucks, defending Super Bowl champions. That should have been the NFL game of the night. Thanksgiving night, it would have broke records. It would have been the highest rated football regular season game watched ever. And then also the NBA playoffs. Some of these teams better wake up. Clippers, tomorrow night, you got another night to think about tonight. Better wake up. Bucks tonight, even though you won game one. Better wake up. Denver tonight. Better wake up. Portland, Melo, Dame Dollar, CJ. They're not playing around. Melo looks focused. Y'all better wake up tonight. LA, I still think, wins that series. I think LA still wins the series, and I still think they win it in six. LeBron and AD are just too good. They lost the first playoff game last year, guys. So, and I know I talk about the AAU bubblegum Mickey Mouse bubble championship. I know, but they still lost the first game and then went on to take care of business. So, that's VJ's Unsportsmanlike Conduct, man. I want to thank everybody for tuning in. I'm your host, VJ Vernon Husky, the Big Vanilla Funny, the Big Vanilla Madden Man. We were live today. I want to thank everybody that was on my IG over here checking me out. I want to thank everybody here on my YouTube channel, StreamYard, everybody on iHeartRadio, and everybody on Spreaker.com. I will be back tomorrow for another super show. We'll talk more NBA. We'll talk some NHL hockey. And we'll talk a little more. Quick sidebar, MLB There's some divisions that are really tight. There's only one or two division guys where, you know, it's over. We are another two teams. There's three divisions where there's three teams that are getting really, really tight. And my Rangers are much better than people thought. 6.5 out of first. Only four games under 500. Won 3 in a row, 6-4 out of our last 10. After a little slump we went through when we lost 7 in a row, but we bounced back with the last 3. Watch the Texas Rangers. They're young. They can pitch. They can hit. They're in a tough division. Oakland's winning that division right now. The Tampa Bay Rays, 10 in a row. Who would have thought it, right? Tampa Bay was supposed to be out of this thing, and it's supposed to be all about the Sox and the Yankees. Yankees fall early. Then they get some momentum. Yankees have won 7 in a row. Tampa's won 7 in a row. Boston seems to be the cream of the crop. Flip over to the NL East. You got the Mets at first place. Both New York teams playing well. It could be that way in LA here in the fall, too, with football. Chargers, Rams can both be good. Both be playoff teams. How would that work? Both be playoff teams if they have home games. Oh, what a predicament. How are they going to fix that? It's SoFi Stadium. That stadium's dope. I want to take my son, man. I want to take my son to a playoff game or to just a regular season game here. I don't even like the Rams. I don't even care about the Rams. But I want to go to SoFi, send that beautiful Cali sun, and get tan. Y'all see quarantine and made me all light again. But we'll see what's up, man. I'll see y'all tomorrow. VJ's on Sports and Light Conduct. Spreaker.com.